Alongside me, a colleague Barbara will be managing the technical side of things now, but she's put together this seminar and the rest of those upcoming as well. I'm very happy to see the interest and people are still joining, obviously. So let me start just with a couple of, let's say, the technical things that need to be get out of the way, and then we'll move on to the actual content of the seminar. As I said, we are recording this. We are also muting all participants. And if you have any kind of comments or questions that you would like answered later on in the seminar, please write them down in the chat function, which you can find on the top of the screen. There is an icon for chat where you can type in your questions. You can also turn on closed captions, so subtitles essentially, which are done automatically. And you can find it again on the top of your screen when the three dots icon should be closed captioning, if that is something you could use during this webinar. I mentioned this is the first one of series of six where we'll talk about all kinds of aspects of employing people with intellectual disabilities in open labor market. It's all part of our project, My Talents for Diversity. We've just been looking at employment of people with intellectual disabilities in the open labor market. We've been working in this project together with our partners, Plena Inclusion in Spain, FPIT in Estonia, and Antwerp Management School here in Belgium. And the purpose of that particular project is to highlight the examples of employers giving work to people with intellectual disabilities, to highlight the support and all kind of reasonable accommodation as well, that helps to improve employment of people with intellectual disabilities in open labor market. And we've created a number of, I think, interesting resources and tools that you can find on our website. There are some videos about reasonable accommodation, about job coaching, and about other aspects. There is training material for employers, how employers can make themselves better suited and let's say more welcoming for people with intellectual disabilities. And there are other elements that you can find, and we'll be obviously sharing the links together with the rest of the materials after the webinar. Mm-hmm. So, and of course, this project is funded by the European Union, for which we are very grateful, and that allows us to have this conversation. And I am particularly delighted today that we can start this series with KLAPjob from Denmark, which is a program supporting employment of people with intellectual disabilities run by our member Lev. And I've been admiring this program for a very, very long time. KLAPjob has managed to employ nearly 4,000 people by now. And of course, we'll have the main speakers here to tell you more about that, but I just want to say that I'm really happy that we can start with learning more about this particular program. So I'll stop talking at this point. We'll show you a very short part of a video that is also introducing how KLAPjob work, and you can later view it and share it with your friends and colleagues after we are done here. And after the video, I will finally introduce and hand over to our colleagues in Denmark, and they will walk you through the details and how KLAPjob works. So let's go on with the video.
Thank you.
Sound. There is no sound.
But anyway,
can Can you?
I can see that.
Did it work? It has
been
That was just to give you a little bit of a taste about the video, and as I said, you can then we'll be sharing the link. And now, without further delays from my side, I'd like to welcome Klaus Bergmann Hansen, who's head of KLAPjob, Tine Stampe, strategic leader of KLAPjob, and Bjorn Burkel, who is KLAPjob ambassador. And I am handing over to you, and then please walk us through what KLAPjob is, how it works, and how it supports people with intellectual disabilities in getting proper work in Denmark.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Thank you. Yes, I'm Tina, and Bjorn, and it's Klaus, and we are very, very thrilled to take part in this series of webinars, and even be the first ones, which also means that we don't really know how things are going to go, get along, but we'll try our best. I'll start off by telling you a bit about LIV, which is the organization behind KLAPjob. It's a member organization with 15,000 members, and it primarily parents for persons with developmental are members of the organization. And this organization 10 years ago took the initiative to make an employment service, which Klaus is going to tell you more about later on. I have been here, I've been with LIV for almost 5 years. I am head of projects, which means that KLAPjob is one of the projects, but we also have other projects covering other sorts of initiatives for people with intellectual disabilities. I don't know if you will, Barbara, could you put on the slides, please?
Yes.
Right, as you can see in the corner, LIV is the major organization, and KLAPjob is one of the initiatives. This is a bit it's a bit unusual that a member organization, a disability organization, actually has an initiative of this size. We are funded by the Danish government, and has been that for 10 years. It's a bit unusual. Will you take the next slide, please? Yeah, this is just the agenda, which Milan has been gone through already. We're going to make a short introduction, and then we are going to make a talk with Bjorn. Explain what it's like to have a KLAPjob, and then Klaus and I will go into details about the more how and why we do it. Next, please. This is what I just told you about LIV, and the principles about employment is actually taken out of the major statements of LIV. We think that it's an asset for any company to employ persons with intellectual disabilities. And that is because we think that the people with intellectual disabilities actually contribute to a rich and diverse society. This is something that we have in common with a lot of NGOs, but it's not always the way it's looked upon by municipalities or job agencies elsewhere. Also, we think that persons with intellectual disabilities have a right to decide where and how they want to work. This is very important in our work because it means that we do not work with visitations. We do not work with people who are being told that they need to get a job, or if the the social services say you must have a job now. We don't collaborate with that type of initiatives. All our jobs are based on the voluntary wish to get a job and be included in ordinary society. The next one. Another principle is that we include a lot of many kinds of intellectual disabilities in our CLAP jobs, meaning that we collaborate with other DPOs. The major group are people with developmental impairment, but we also include autism, ADHD, cerebral palsy, epilepsy, psychological traumas. We have a lot of people with that, and acquired brain injury, and others smaller as well. One of the issues is that a lot of people actually have several diagnoses, but we don't focus on that. We just focus on the fact that they are willing to have this kind of job, and how they define themselves is not a matter for us. Next one. Yep. So this sums up in the KLAPjob principles, that we have a focus on the skills and the need for support, and not a focus on the diagnosis. We cooperate with the companies. Klaus is going to talk a lot about that. And we, as a ground principle, we define the jobs first, and then we start the matching. We will get into that later. What this is a basic principle, what that means. Then there's another basic principle, is that the wages must be supported by public grants. We don't expect companies to pay the full wages. We expect the society to take part in this project and add something to the wages. So that's the first, that was the first kind of introduction to the whole setup.
No other companies. Yeah. Yes. This is the companies we have, we make jobs in. We make jobs in around 25 big companies. That means around 60% of the job makes, and the rest of the jobs is made in small companies. The idea in KLAPjob is that we work basically with big companies nationwide. And one of the companies you can see is you can see that Rema 1000 in the middle, in top, beside McDonald's. And this is where Björn is working. And in fact, we have just passed almost 600 jobs in Rema 1000. Mm-hmm. So we make a lot of jobs there, and they are almost the same jobs. That means when we make a deal with Rema 1000, we were talking about what can people with mentally disability make in the company. And when we have made that together with Rema 1000's head office, they say to me or to Klaus that we can hire 500 people are able to do this. Then the jobs are going out to our local consultants, and the local consultants talk about with the branches of Rema 1000, you know, Tina, maybe you have to help me with the English. Rema 1000 is a chain of shops, you know, they have around 500 shops around them. So the local consultants are talking with the leader of the local shop and ask, do you want a person who are working in KLAPjob? And they say yes. And then Björn is hired by one of the leaders of the local shops. That's the whole idea. So what we do in KLAP is we always make the jobs first. And then we talk with the people with mentally disability who want a job. And then we ask them, where do we want to work? So we always have a job ready for them. We have several jobs ready for them when we have the talk with the people who want a job through us.
Barbara, could you please take off the slides now, unless you want to talk more about it, please.
I do that later.
Okay? Yes.
Turn off the slides. So you were talking about the having a wide range of job openings.
Yes.
Available every time an applicant arrives and says, I'd like to have a job, then you can show them a whole range of jobs straight away.
Yes. The problem is when we are talking with the people who want a job, we have to find out what they want, but we all also want to show them we have jobs already for them. So the people we are talking with sometimes say, I want to make something that is a dream job for them, you know, working with as a professional football player or something like that. And then we say, that's very interesting, but we have a job for you right here. Do you want this job or this job or this job? And what happens is that the people look down at the job we have, and then they choose one of them because they are ready, and they are, the companies say, if you want this job, you can get a job tomorrow. So that's the basic principle in KLAP. If we have a person who wants something very special, we don't go out and find a special job for the person. We say it will take time. So maybe you have to take one of the jobs we already have ready for you here on the spot.
The idea about this is also that this is the same way the labor market works for everybody else.
Exactly.
Nobody is interested in me coming and saying, oh, I want to be a space agent or something. I mean, I have to take the jobs that are available. And what we have done is we have created demands for this kind of labor that people with intellectual disabilities can perform. And it is very satisfying.
Okay.
To experience that actually when they come to our job agents, there's always ready a demand for the things they can do. We can ask Bjorn about that later.
And what about, should we talk with Bjorn?
Bjorn is not so good in English, so I will talk to him in Danish and Tina will translate. Okay? So you have to give us a little time. Is that okay?
Yes. Yes.
Sure.
Hi, Bjorn.
Hi, sir.
What am I doing?
Bjorn's telling us that he works in the Remat 1000 in Denmark. It's a big retail.
Yeah.
Are you glad for it?
Yeah.
He's very pleased with it.
Hvor lang tid har du været?
3 år.
He's been there for 3 years.
Hvad lavede du før?
Jeg har fået beskyttet et værksted. Socialt værksted.
Before that, he was in a sheltered workshop. He calls it a social workshop.
Mm. What are you doing?
Any questions? No, no. I heard something noises.
It's a lot.
Hvad laver du? Jeg ved
ikke, jeg tænker også, at jeg gulvet, og gange, så sorterer jeg også, ja, så nogle gange, så skal jeg også være der sammen, så skal jeg til luftbutikken, og det er nogle ting.
In Remat 1000, he does service jobs. He sits in the counter, and he's on the floor. I have to ask him, hvad er det, vi har på gulvet?
I kassen.
Det er, du går rundt og fjerner pap og
det er noget mest i kassen.
He's mostly at the counter, and then sometimes he also assists in closing the shop trimming the shelves.
Og så er der faktisk en spændende historie, fordi at, at dengang du startede Rema, der havde du problemer med læseskrift og, og tal. Men alligevel så gjorde Claus det, at han hjalp dig til at komme i kassen.
Claus is remembering that when Bjørn started in KLAPjob, he had problems with reading and writing. So he was very pleased that that Claus actually believed that he could handle a job.
Yeah, but I have to say it's because there's two Clauses here. There's me, I'm Claus, and his boss in Rema 1000 is also named Claus.
Oh, so
it's not the same person. I have to tell the team that. No, his leader said, even you cannot write or read, we can help you sit at the counter. So what his boss, also named Claus, did was he helped Bjørn to be able to sit at the counter. And that's very, very good of him. And it's, of course, as his leader in Rema 1000, it's also a very good thing for him. But he took the time to learn Bjørn how to sit at the counter. Det forklarer Claus tog tid til det. Hvad, ud over at du var på beskyttet værksted før, hvordan havde du det med det, sådan i det hele taget, at være på beskyttet?
Psykisk dårlig. Vi havde det godt, og ja, jeg følte mig nedprioriteret.
John was not very happy with the sheltered workshop. He felt not very prioritized, and he felt down.
I have to make a comment about that, because the story is that the Bjørn in fact was in a Rema 1000 shop, the same shop, not the same shop, but the same brand of shops he was when he was in the sheltered workshops. But he did not work. Bjørn felt not that he was not happy there. People did not value him or anything. But when he got a real job, full KLAPjob, something good happens. He felt married because he get paid for his job.
Hvad der så sket, mens du har været i KLAPjob, udover at du arbejder der?
Ja, jeg ved at tænke, at til 9 og 10, så vil jeg gerne læse grafisk design.
He's taking a an education alongside with his job in Rema. He's finishing secondary school,
yeah.
The basic schools.
The basic school. Basic. So he can learn to read.
So this means that he's gone to school for like 7 or 8 years, and now he's taking the 9th and the 6th grade. And after that he wants to be a graphic designer.
Men du blev også KLAPjob ambassadør. Hvorfor valgte du at blive?
Jeg vil gerne fortælle andre, at man godt kan det, man kan i Grønland.
And is also a KLAPjob self ambassador.
We call it a KLAPjob ambassador.
Yeah. A self-advocate, which we call an ambassador. Because he wants to tell others about what it's like to have a job and what possibilities they actually have.
So what we have done is that we have made six KLAPjob ambassadors. That means people who have a KLAPjob and want to share their experience with other people who are thinking about getting a KLAPjob. Bjørn is one of them. He is very productive.
Du er meget, Signe, du går meget op i hver KLAPjob.
Det er
fortæl, hvad du har lavet.
Jeg har været med mange borgmester, så er det Christiansborg, og jeg søger bare, at alle skal have det så godt, som jeg har haft det. Så jeg vil gerne gøre den forskel, jeg har gjort, det vil jeg gerne gøre til andre, kan få samme succes.
Bjørn actually arranges meeting with mayors around the place where he live in the municipalities. He's been to several meetings with mayors. He's been to the parliament and met the
Dansk
ordfører
for Socialdemokratiet.
Oh yeah, and met some of the MPs and And he's just always agitating that the other people should have the same opportunities that he's had.
So Bjorn and I have been together to 5, I think, meetings with males in Denmark. We have 97 of them, I think, of the males. And they're listening to us, and they say it's a very good idea to get a CLAP job. You can see what Bjørn finds out of that. So vil du fortælle noget om, hvordan det er at arbejde sammen med og snakke med Poulsen?
Det er fantastisk. Jeg har aldrig troet, at jeg skulle gøre det her, som jeg har gjort nu. Jeg har givet mig også en tro på det sidste møde, jeg havde med en borgmester i det her. Hun sagde, vi stempler folk, og vi gør til, at systemet skal stemple. Det vil vi gerne gå op imod, og det synes jeg er fantastisk, at sådan politikere og andre, der siger, vi skal gå op imod sådan det her, der er i dag, at vi skal gå op imod, at vi skal vise andre, vi godt kan. Og det er derfor, jeg synes, det er så vigtigt, at vi skal have det fokus, der er i Danmark og i udlandet.
I never thought that he was going to have so much influence with mayors and politicians, and he's very impressed that actually he meets people who says that they want to go against the stigmatization of persons with intellectual disabilities, and it's a great cause.
I mean, it's a great story, great element to what you are describing, kind of having the job helping Bjørn to being recognized first in the company and then sort of making another step into the advocacy work and talking to mayors and kind of through that job getting, let's say, being more valued, to use the words that you said, and then kind of getting more experience, not only for the job itself, but kind of the job being the opening doors to other sort of roles, which I obviously think is incredibly important, the value of having a job. It's not just about the income, it's a lot about being recognized as someone who is expert at something, who can do something, but also having that social role and having that opportunity to develop other social roles. I think that's very important that you talk about it directly. Can we just maybe take a step back a little bit and can you tell us about how KLAPjob actually supported Bjorn in getting that job, like more specifically what it actually meant for Bjorn to receive KLAPjob support to make the step up from the sheltered workshops into the job?
That's a good idea. I think I will explain something first myself. What we do is, as I was talking about the companies before, when you saw the slide about which company we're working together with, what we do always is we make the jobs first. The jobs are in something we have in Denmark called JobNet, where all jobs in Denmark are. We have around 300 jobs there, and they are all CLAP jobs, and they are open for the people who want to have a CLAP job. Some of them are able to find the jobs themselves. Some of them are helped by relatives, parents, social workers, who know. And then they find the job in there. And then they send a request for the job to one of the people we have working here, and then say they send the request to our consultants. We have, you can see here, we have around 12 consultants in Denmark, and they are getting the request from Bjørn that Bjørn wanted the job. And then I ask Bjørn how he got the job, okay?
Hvordan fik du jobbet i Hamilton?
Jeg søgte via nettet, jeg så på YouTube, og ja, jeg så på de sociale medier.
Hvem havde fortalt dig, at du kunne lide det?
Ikke nogen.
Ja, Bjørn selv gør. Det kan du selv.
Okay, Bjørn was searching on the internet and through YouTube and the other channels. As we have told you, he spends a lot of time with the technology and social media. And then he found the opportunity. He found the CLAP jobs that way, and he took contact with one of the job agents to help him.
Så finder du Stine?
Ja. Og vi skriver og ringer sammen, og så finder han et job.
So he talked to one of the job agents, and she actually
assumed. She's there.
And as soon as, var det med det samme, på det første møde, der havde hun et job?
Nej, der gik et par uger, så sagde hun. Fordi jeg benægtede faktisk at komme i den ræme og komme ud, fordi jeg faktisk har haft en dårlig oplevelse. Og så sagde hun, skal vi prøve igen? Og så sagde jeg jo, fordi så havde hun faktisk en butik til mig.
Okay, so it he says, I'm asking, did you get a job immediately? No, he said, it took 2 weeks. So because first he didn't want to go to that Rema shop because he didn't like the shop, but then she said, oh, let's try because they really want you. And then he said, okay, and it worked.
So the system is that we try to copy the normal labor market in Denmark. That means these jobs are open for the people who are interested in them. And there's a special thing happening because we don't have visitation. We don't have anyone who say to Bjorn, you have to get a job. He wants to have a job. He come to us and we find a job for him. So even it's in the same chain of shops, Bjørn find out it's very good for him and he's very happy to be there. Did that was the answer on the question, Milan, or do you want me to explain more?
Yeah, maybe I still think a little bit more on actually what is the, I think we get the picture that you always start with the job, so it's about creating or defining the opportunities in various employers and then offering those and looking for a person who would be interesting. But what does it actually mean, like when Bjorn talks to the I didn't catch the name, but to the agent of KLAPjob, like what are the interactions actually about? Is there also, I guess, some sort of training involved, and is that training involved in before he or she gets the job, or is it after? I need more details on the actual workings of supporting a particular person into getting that job and staying in that job as well. I think it's an important element.
Try with the description of the jobs, perhaps.
Yeah, but maybe, but there's a period on 1 month where you is in practice at the shop
internship.
But there's no support in that internship. The idea is then when we are working with the big companies, we are telling them how they have to react when they want to hire this people, and what they have to know and what they have to understand about them. But we are not doing it. That means when the consultant working for KLAP who find the job for Bjørn, she's talking with the leader of the shop and look at him and say, it's a very good idea that you want some of our people to hire, but you have to understand there's some difficulties you have to know. And one of them is you have to give yourself time. You have to give one
task
at the time. You have to take it slow. You have to explain things maybe 2-3 times. But if you do that, if you invest this in your KLAPjobber, then you can have a very, very good employee through the years ahead. So of course we try to tell the companies that their head office, but also the local leaders how they have to reacts, but we don't do it. That means the consultant is not coming together with Bjorn working in the shop, but she's overlooking it and she's there for Bjorn when he calls and have questions, and she's also there for the leader if he calls and have questions.
I think a lot of the work that could be used if there was some assistant following Bjørn or some other applicant into the shop and guiding and training. I think a lot of that work is done when we define the job. We spend a lot of time with the company beforehand. We walk around with the company saying, here are some tasks that needs to be done. And we know by experience that they can be done by somebody with intellectual disabilities. It's all founded on this idea that we have 10 years of experience with what is the general kind of tasks persons with intellectual disabilities can manage. And this was a great surprise for me when I started here 5 years ago, that it was so, there was so much in common that you don't have to design every job special. There are so many things in common with all kinds of persons that you can define the job that is that's available, that's suitable for a lot of people. Actually, what happened is when my son he finished high school, he was looking for a job, and the best jobs he found were the ones that were called KLAPjob. And he came back to me and said, "Mom, I found some very good jobs, but they're all reserved for people with disabilities." And this means that these things that we offer with these jobs are actually things that a lot of people would like to have. Short hours, one task at a time, nice and quiet, and
give me time.
Colleagues, yeah. Good colleagues at yeah. work. That's what we all like.
I think this is actually a very interesting and important element of what you are describing, and I would say that it might be a key kind of difference of KLAPjob compared to other maybe let's say more common ways of supporting people in getting employment, and that's that you actually don't provide the support in getting an employment. If you get what I mean, you focus on the job, you focus on the work with the employer in creating the job in the correct conditions, and then telling the also educating the employer on what kind of support and training needs to be given to a person, but you don't actually provide that support yourself. You make the match between the job and the person, and that's it for you, right?
More than that, the companies say to us or to me, who I made the deals with companies, we don't want any support. You have to promise us there's not coming any support into our shops. That's important for them. I know when we have international visit in KLAPjob, I know this can be provocative to many, but the problem is if you are leader of a shop, you don't want to handle two people. You want to handle one people. You say, it's my employee. I want to handle him or her. So even many of us, when we do the support to the companies, we do it because we want to help them. You have to look at it from the other side also, at when you have a lot of people working for you, the problem can be that the company owner can feel that they have to discuss with two people, the supporter and the worker, instead of when it's only the people you employ in your shop you are talking with. Of course, Bjørn and anyone else we have get a job to can call us in the evening if something goes wrong and we talk with the company, but we are still not there. What we say to everyone we have get a job to is you have to find out with your boss. All we other do is the same. So the idea is that we help them, we support them, we push them to find out and solve their problems together with their local leaders. So this is very important.
Yeah, thank you. I think really that this I think you yourself are saying that when you have visitors from other countries, that they kind of this might be that something let's say maybe unusual compared to other models when the support is directly involved. And I think it's important to kind of make that distinction here and make it very clear. I have a couple of questions here now in the chat function and on basically, let's say, the financial side of the arrangements. Just before we get to them, a reminder for all the other participants, you can also write your questions in the chat box. You will find it on the top of your screen and just type in the questions you want to ask or any comments you want to make. And we have a question here. How much is the support from the government? What is sort of the monthly sum being paid for the employer?
I know Tina have made something about that, and we will tell that, but I think it's fair to ask Björn about how he was feeling, because there was no support for him in the shop before we are leaving that topic. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
Bjørn, hvordan det vi diskuterer, det er det med, om man skal, der skal være nogen, så der ligesom kommer en pædagog med dig, og hjælper dig ind i arbejdet. I forhold til KLAPs-model, som jo er KLAPs og de andre hjælperne ind i arbejdet. Hvordan havde du det med det, dengang du startede op?
Det var dejligt. Der er ikke nogen andre ind over.
Hvordan?
Du skal sige.
Det var rart at blive befriet for alt det der beskyttelse.
Okay. Bjørn didn't have any support when he started in his job, and he says it was really nice. It was nice not to have all this kind of caring and protection.
He said it was wonderful.
Oh, yes, okay. Wonderful. And but to be on his own and not have protection all the time.
Vil du sige mere?
What about the challenges?
Det er fint at gøre, man kommer væk fra alt det her system, fra det sociale og social virksomhed. Der var nogen om der hele tiden. Her, der er nogen, du kan. De ser ikke ned på dig, de ser op til dig.
It was a relief to get away from the social systems and to get to a place where people don't look down upon you, but look up to you, because you can do things.
So there's one thing I will say about this, because this have always been a discussion in KLAPjob, how we do this. But what we always hear from the people working in KLAPjobs is they think it's wonderful coming from a system where people get money to help them, and they're coming into a system where people are paying money for having them. I know we don't see it like that. But of course, Björn understand that the people around him in the sheltered workshop was paid for making him feel good. But now he's coming into a shop where the leaders say, I need you, I want to give money for you. So there's a very big difference in that. And that we always hear that when there are people in South Africa.
And we'll move on, Milan, to the question about the economics.
Yeah, right. So sorry, we actually have another question here which is still related to this subject, so let's go to that one and we'll get to the financial questions a little bit later.
Okay.
So the question is essentially, since there is no direct support as you are doing, like how do you sort of monitor or kind of follow up on the adaptation of that person into the job? Is there kind of any kind of monitoring, let's say, of how the relationship essentially works?
It's working like that our consultants know these people, they know the shops where they are hired, and their phone are always open. That means that all the consultants every day get calls from people who have a club job asking about things and how they want to do it. And our answer is always, have you talked to your boss about this problem? And if they did not talk with their boss, we say, you have to do that first. But you can also talk with your local part of the union. What we do is that we support them also to get into normal unions, because that is also where we solve problems with bosses. If there's anything you have to discuss, you can discuss with your boss, and you can also discuss it with your union. So our phones is open, and we are not coming out and solving normal, simple problems for the people.
We have a very close cooperation with the parties of the labor market, meaning that we have arranged for this type of labor force that they can get a discount if they join, when they join the union, and we always suggest them to be members of a union, because as Klaus says, that's the
normal way.
That's the normal way to do it.
But of course, we also have the talks with the companies, the big companies, who tell me how long time the people are working there. We have the people working in the same shop 5 years, 7 years, 8 years, and we also have a consulate company
for what?
For this one, for telling how long a person normally is in a club job. So we know that our people after 2 years, 74% of them is still working in the first club job they got, or the second. So they have a high
retention
level of retention rate. Thank you, boss. So they're having a very good work life, and they are happy about this.
Okay, thank you very much again. I maybe try to summarize, and we'll now move to, we have a bunch of questions on the financial side of this. So we'll move on to it now. But I think what is important again is to highlight that the focus of KLAPjob is to creating the job, creating the work opportunities, describing them properly, making them in such a way that they are suitable to have someone who has some sort of disability, and working with the employer to be ready to, let's say, receive that person. And then you leave it kind of to the employer to deal with that side of it. You don't intervene. And I would say it's like basically trying to run the thing as close to a normal employment relationship as it would be, and with your emphasis also on joining the trade unions and stuff. And I think that's a really important element of how this works. Let's maybe, if there is a couple of things you would like to start by yourself saying about, let's say, the financial side of how of the arrangement, and then we can get on to the questions, see if we've answered them already. But if there is something you've prepared on the financial arrangement of KLAPjob, let's start with that first, please.
Yes. This the way we do things can only work because the applicants for KLAPjobs and the employees already receive a disability grant, a disability pension from the government. This means that they receive around 2,500 euros a month, which sounds like perhaps like a lot, but it just covers a decent standard of living, and that is a grant that all people with disabilities get, or it used to be that way. What we ask the companies to do is just to top up that pension with like approximately 25%, so when Bjorn gets a job, he improves his standard of living with 25%. But at the same time, the 25% is only is only a small amount for the companies, so that makes them more liable to employ people this way. What we of course want is that there's a direct connection between the standard, the quality of work that the companies get, and the price they pay. It's very important, because if they feel that they pay more than they get, they won't join this kind of program. And So this is one of the basic basic principles for the whole thing to work. We also have another kind of disability pension, which is a bit lower in Denmark. But we have arranged in KLAPjob, we go into some kind of negotiation with the municipalities about if people with a lower disability pension, if they also want to get a KLAPjob, they have to the job has to be the kind of the same, and the support that these people get from the municipality has to be also the same as if they got a full pension. This is a bit complicated, but the point is that the jobs are all almost the same. It is simple, service-minded, unskilled jobs. And that means that the qualifications you need for that is worth almost the same for all these kinds of employees. So the company knows almost exactly what they need to pay for them, and they find that the price is suitable. It's okay with them. So
okay.
But this has in order for us to. I know that in some other countries you're trying to persuade the companies to pay the full wages, and in our opinion, it doesn't work, or at least what we can demonstrate is that there needs to be a kind of engagement from the government and from the municipalities in this program. Otherwise, it doesn't work.
Yeah. So just to make, thank you for the introduction, just to make this clear, essentially, in many countries, the problem when people who have some sort of disability benefits find a job, they basically lose that disability income because they are making other money. I understand this is not the case. Like basically, a person keeps the benefits plus earns money on top of that, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. And then we have the question of, is there some sort of government contribution towards the salary? So basically paying the employers to pay for the jobs. Is there any kind of government subsidy for the employers on this?
Yes, there is a bit as well. The employee gets around 5-6 euros an hour, and the company can apply for a reduction
around two and a half, three
euros. So yes, there is it is cheap for the companies. For us, it is not a question of being able to support yourself. It is a question of inclusion. This program is all about inclusion. It is not about being able to support your own life, because that would never ever be possible for this type of disabilities.
But the governor supports for the weights is not big for the companies. When I make the first arrangement with the companies many years ago, in fact with Rema 1000, where Björn is working, they have hired 100 people before they find out they could get the support from the government for hiring these people. Because what they think was that the weights we found and what our people was able to work for them, that was a very good match. And what we do is normally we pay around 40% of the normal minimum wages in Denmark for our people who is working in a KLAPjob. That's of course because they are paid by the government from their, what do you call it?
Disability pension.
So it's enough money for the KLAPjob worker to, if you lose the money, you need the money. So it's enough to what you can say, do the normal idea when you are working that you have more benefits and you can buy more things.
Kan, vil du fortælle om din hvor meget får du i førtidspension? Du får 18.000.
Nej, hvor meget får jeg ikke?
14. Og hvor meget får du så for dit klapjob?
På nede tid så får jeg 1.100.
Sådan noget af den stil, ja.
1.600.
Sådan noget af den stil.
So Bjørn, what Bjørn is saying is he around 200 euros on top of his disability pension a month, and that's of course money for him also.
Okay, well, a number of questions now about what would be the weekly hours typically, like what kind of hours are we talking here? For the employer, for a typical KLAPjob.
Last year it was 18.3 hours a week in
Gimnesis. On average.
On average, yeah. Okay. So,
hvor meget arbejde?
Bjørn is working 16 hours a week.
But it can vary, and very often an employee will start with 10 hours and to see how things work, and then they will work their way up until they reach like 18-20 hours. That's possible.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. There's a, and I'm not sure I will be asking this correctly, so Matthias, if you want to then clarify maybe if I'm asking your question correctly, but is this system flexible, and what if they stop using KLAPjob? But I guess that means if the employer kind of stops using that, what either, or I don't know, wants to terminate the situation, what are the consequences for the employee, or what's sort of the relationship there if if the relationship between KLAPjob and then the employer doesn't work out, what's the relationship around that, I guess? What if they stop with KLAPjob is the question.
Yeah, what you can say is we have a privilege in KLAPjob. That means we have more than jobs enough. So when a person working in a KLAPjob comes to us and say, I don't like my boss, he keeps saying I have to do this and I don't want to do that, and I have talked to him and he still say I have to do that, then we say, then quit. We can give you a new job in another company from one day to the other. And that's how we deal with things, because we have jobs enough. So normally what happens is if you are not happy in your first job, you are normally happy in your second. And we also help people getting your third KLAPjob if things are not working. Of course, we are talking with the KLAPjobbers about what went wrong and what can you learn out of that. If you have a big discussion with your boss all the time, then you have to say, okay, I have to do what he say, because that's the system when you're working for someone. So our consultant is always helping to get a new job. And sometimes one of them also needs 3 or 4 months when you don't have any job to relax and think about things. And then they come back to us and say, okay, I need the money, I need the job. And I find out maybe next time I do as my boss say, because that's how things are working. And we say, that's a good idea. Then we find you a new job.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. We have a number of comments more than question, I guess, now around, let's say, the financial arrangements and especially the relationship between the benefits and the government subsidies for this to work. Basically saying that in several countries, yeah, the resources invested into this wouldn't be so great, so that would be kind of limiting the possibilities of applying the same kind of system. Another comment says that in Ireland there is a minimum requirement of 20 hours per week for the employers to get that sort of subsidy for employing people with intellectual disabilities, and that might be quite a lot for a lot of them. So it's kind of a barrier in creating employment opportunities for many people. Just to maybe wrap up on the topic of the financial arrangements, I think that you've kind of clearly described the role of the benefits and how the employment salary basically tops up on that, and that there is sort of contribution from the public purse. And I don't think we need to get into much of a more detail than that, because these aspects will obviously be very different in every country. And since I'm mentioning every country, and I have to ask this question, it's being asked by our president, so I have to obey. What would be your recommendation if KLAPjob was to kind of scale into other countries? What would be the first things you would recommend people, organizations to focus on? Like, if you were to go and apply KLAPjob in other countries, what would be your recommendations that people should start with?
This is so complicated, because these systems are these social benefit systems are so different in all countries. For instance, for the Irish people, I would recommend them to invite us over and help them explain that, of course, you can't have a minimum limit of hours when you are working with people with intellectual disabilities. You have to accept that they need few hours.
The other thing
mm-hmm. was that there are many other expenditures apart from the disability pension. The municipalities have a lot of expenses with people with disabilities. So what we did was that we made out an analysis with the bureau that showed that every municipality saves 10,000 euro every year for every person that we get into a job. And this is one of the arguments that I would actually also recommend for other countries. It is to do, it's a kind of a business analysis, it's a business case that you can show your authorities where is the what kind of assets is there with this program. And one, of course, is a better life condition, an improvement in life, but the other one is actually that there is a lot of savings on social benefits, public social benefits. It worked for us with this argument for some years.
What I can say on some the level where we are making jobs, we have been copied in Norway. I don't know if we have told anyone, but there's a copy of KLAPjob in Norway. So, and they're working like we are working. There's several things that when we were starting working with the companies, that the first deal I made with a company was, we all know, McDonald's. And when I was talking to the leaders of McDonald's in Denmark, they said to me that they have from the international McDonald's in America, in US, they have to hire as many people with disability as there is
percentage
in the country where they are working. And the problem is that you cannot in Denmark say I have a person with disability working for me, because you cannot tell that when you are hiring a people. But what they found out is that when they're working for KLAPjob, I can send message to them every year how many people we have working KLAPjob in McDonald's, and they sent that to the main head office in US. So in fact, there was a benefit of doing that, and we do that with other companies also, that they want to hire people with disability, and we are helping them with that. So it was not that difficult to find make a deal with the big companies.
But the companies are almost never the problem. The problem is always some kind of juridical complication with the government or the municipality. That's what we discover all the time. It's hardly ever the company.
Can I ask one question to Bjorn here, because you are sitting here? Because we are talking about changing jobs in KLAPjob.
Hvad er dine tanker om at blive rigtig? Du er jo faktisk blevet lidt træt af KLAPjob. Mm-hmm. Fortæl Tine, hvad du tænker. Hvad er der sket?
Jeg skal lige formulere det rigtigt, tænker jeg. Jeg vil gerne prøve noget andet, og gerne vil ud i ordinært arbejdsmarked, som jeg har været i. Jeg vil gerne ud og arbejde på kontorer, fordi jeg har en skade i mit knæ, der gør, at jeg skal opereres her lige om lidt. Jeg bliver nødt til at skal videre i livet.
Mm-hmm. Så du snakker med Stine om at få et nyt job, ikke?
Ja.
Ja.
Og det lykkedes ikke lige helt, så jeg prøver noget andet. Jeg tager en anden vej.
Bjørn is also actually looking for another job because he wants to get on in life, and he wants to get an office job because he's got an injury in his knee, so he would like to change from Rema to another kind of job. He's been trying for a while, but he hasn't found the right one yet.
So what we do is we are of course supporting Bjørn in finding a new job. He had to move on in life. He had been there for 3 years, and many of us, we know that that then you want to do something else, and of course we are supporting him.
Yeah. Have you got more questions,
Nina? Yeah, sure. I will definitely have more questions. We have first, if it would be possible, to share with us also the business case that you mentioned. Well, we would be interested to see it, and I mean the evaluation of the costs and the cost, let's say the cost benefits that you talked about, savings on the benefits if employment is done, and obviously the participants are interested in this too, so if we could share it, it would be very good. And then we have a question: if there are any jobs in KLAPjob that actually require some sort of certificate. So I guess the question is about more qualified jobs, if there are any in the program.
The last, there's not.
The short the short answer is no. We sometimes come across applicants who say that they are not attracted to our jobs because they are not interesting enough. And then we are just saying, these jobs are very, very good for around 30,000 people in Denmark. But and if you need another kind of job, then you have to try somewhere else. So no, we are not, it's not in the program. We specialize on this, and this is what we stick to. As I say, Liv has estimated that there is a market for 30,000 of these jobs in Denmark, and we have only made almost 4,000.
Okay, so still a room for growth in this. Yeah. But I think that this gives us a pretty decent picture of how KLAPjob works and what are the key elements are. So thank you very much. Maybe let's move on to the other aspect you mentioned at the beginning. And since we have Bjorn here, I think it would be interesting to talk about a little bit more as well. And that's the ambassador role of KLAPjob. So if Bjorn could describe to us a little bit more about how this works, what this is all about and how that works.
The ambassador role.
Yes, the ambassador, KLAPjob ambassador, yes.
Han vil gerne høre noget om, hvordan det er at være ambassadør. Hvad hedder det? Prøv at fortæl, hvordan fik du ideen, og hvem var det, der henvendte dig til Stine, eller Stine, der henvendte sig til dig, eller prøv at fortæl til lidt om det, hvad der skete dengang.
Nej, det var faktisk ikke nogen af os.
Okay.
Så havde jeg opstået på Facebook, og det var stadig de sociale medier. Jeg bruger meget de sociale medier til at holde mig opdateret. Og stadigvæk er sociale medier meget af mit liv. Og det var sådan, jeg fandt ambassadøren, og så kontaktede projektlederen mig og sagde, at det kunne han godt tænke sig, at jeg var med i.
Bjørn heard about the ambassador role on the social media, on the Facebook, and it just was very appealing to him. So he contacted the Klaus Orstein and said he would like to join that. Så hvad er det, du fortæller borgmesteren?
Jeg fortæller, at det er vigtigt, at man ligesom skal samarbejde med de borgere, der sidder derude og bare kigger på en skærm.
What he tells the mayors is that it's very important to cooperate with the citizens who are just passive, not employed with anything, just watching their TV or their screens.
Så synes jeg også, at det er vigtigt, at man ligesom står sammen om og skal udbrede det her. Det er noget, der ikke kun er i Danmark, at det her, hvordan kan man sige, at ensomheden, den bliver mere, man bliver mere ensom.
Mm-hmm.
Det synes jeg godt, at det her arbejde, selvom man får et arbejde, så får man også noget socialt liv.
He's very, very concerned about loneliness, which is not just in Denmark, but everywhere. And he's very concerned with the fact that when you get a job, you get a social life.
Ja, det vil jeg faktisk gerne. Og så er det vigtigt, at man ligesom husker at fortælle, hvor godt det er for systemet at tage hånd om deres syge eller deres sværeste borgere.
And it's important for the social system to take care of their most vulnerable citizens.
Der er også den sjove historie med Henrik Burkhæl og dig.
Helt tilfældigt, så finder jeg ud af, at direktøren for det arbejde, jeg arbejder ind under, Rema 1000 Danmark, at direktøren, vi er familie sammen.
Oh, he finds out by coincidence that the CEO of the place where he works is actually a relative of his.
I think it's your grandparent there, right? Your grandparents as subjects, I think. So it's funny. So the main director for Rema 1000, he has 15,300 employees, and one of them is Kasper. So that's funny. So you have his phone number and can call him if you want to talk. That's cool. I don't have that.
Yeah, no, I think it again points out the, as Bjorn says, the social life or inclusion role of the whole program and of employment. It's the kind of making those connections or being able to have different roles and different relations. So I guess being a KLAPjob ambassador involves traveling around Denmark, telling others about the benefits of the program, both potential employers and potential employees. What are, let's say, typical questions maybe the typical questions that people have, Pierre, when you are talking to them about the program? What do they most want to know about it?
Yeah, but you can also say that we have also find out, we have done this with the ambassadors for 1.5 years. And there's something, also something, cannot call it bad habiting, but some of the ambassadors will like better to be ambassadors than working in their normal KLAPjob.
And politicians.
So they want to be politicians. So in fact, we have one of Bjorn's ambassador colleagues who have stopped working in his KLAPjob and instead want to be politicians. And of course, we support that. But what we can say is that it's important when you want to be a KLAPjob ambassador, you need to have a KLAPjob, or else you cannot do that. So what we, of course, is finding out is that the ambassador role cannot be take too much time for them, because or else they will not be able to have their normal.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know if I feel that's
Bjørn say yes, it's more funny to more nice to be a KLAPjob ambassador than working in the shop. So
okay. Well, maybe another reminder, if there are any further questions from participants, please write them into chat. And we will ask them, but to give people some time to do that, have we left any of the, let's say, defining features of KLAPjob that you prepared in the presentations? Have we covered everything?
Yes, I think so. We've covered the basic things, and there are other things, but they are more specific Danish, you know, like the problems with the sheltered workshops. And when KLAPjob was still young, we actually did a lot of recruiting of applicants for the jobs. We don't need that anymore, because the applicants just keep coming in on their own. But in the beginning, We went around to visit the sheltered workshops and do campaigns for them to consider if they wanted a job. And we experienced a lot of anticipation from the sheltered workshops because they didn't want to let their clients go. They wanted to keep them in the workshops. And that is why what I said in the beginning, that one of our basic principles is the right to choose, the right to choose yourself. If you want to be in, if you want to take an education, if you want to be in a sheltered workshop, or if you want to be in a job in the open labor market. And we are even going further than that. We now fight in live in the big organization, we fight for the right to do all three. Like, you can have a job on Monday and you can have education on Tuesday, and you can go to a club or a sheltered workshop where you can do your music on Wednesday. And that is the best world of all.
Exactly. That's the absolute best.
Okay. Well, no further questions arrived from participants.
I actually have a few questions.
So we can, Barbara.
Yes, thank you so much for all the explanations. I was wondering, because in the project, in the My Talents for Diversity project, we have been talking a lot about the effects that the pandemic could cause in the employment situation, people with intellectual disabilities. And I was wondering if you have any insights to share in relation to that, if affected, and if so, how it affected the work developed by KLAPjob.
Yeah, that's a very clever question. What Corona did, it changed everything for us. We had to stop working outside our offices. And that meant there was a lot of people working in KLAPjob who was calling our consulates and asking if they had to go to job, or they have to stay at home, or what they have to do. So it was a lot of special work that time, finding out what was the best for the single person working in a KLAPjob. What gjorde du I? I'm asking Bjørn about what he did in the corona situation. What gjorde du I?
I coronatiden, der måtte jeg faktisk ikke arbejde for min læge.
Nej.
Jeg blev sendt hjem og skulle bare være derhjemme.
Og til hvad eksamen vil du oversætte okay. først?
Bjørn is a special vulnerability. So he was ordered home by his doctor.
Hvad sagde Klaus til?
Han var ikke så glad for det. Han sagde, at han må ikke gå imod myndighedernes ord.
And but the point is that actually Bjørn's manager Klaus was very disappointed about that because he needed him. So but he said he couldn't go against the doctor's orders.
Hvad ellers? Hvor lang tid var du hjemme?
3 måneder.
3 måneder.
So he stayed home for 3 months.
Fik du løn?
Ja. Yeah.
And he was paid. He was paid within the normal system of this is difficult. When you are employed and you get
you're sick, you get
you
get money from the company, money from the company.
Yeah. Yes.
But the important is that Bjørn still get his pay from the company, even mm-hmm. he was not working.
Mm-hmm.
And what else? There was a lot of these different situations. Some of the people working as a KLAPjob was sent home. Some of them was still working. My own son is one of them in a KLAPjob who is still working in his job, and he was proud. Because he was a part of what he was taking, holding Denmark open, because he was working in the shop. And then he said, it's important everyone can buy food. So I'm proud that I can be a part of holding Denmark open for everyone. So you can say that that after the 2-3 months, that was very special. Many are still in the same job. Some are stopped getting another job, but most of them is job back in their normal jobs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the point is the reason they get paid is of course that they have contracts just like any other employee. They don't have special contracts. They have contracts with the same on the same premises as every other employee,
mm-hmm.
with all the same benefits.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We have one more question, Govik. Step back on your working with the, let's say, the competition with shelter workshops, and basically how at the beginning, especially, how did you manage to reach out to people working in the workshops? If there was some sort of you talk about. Let's say some sort of resistance from the workshops to let people go out of there. So how did you overcome this, and how did you reach out to the people working in the workshops so they could benefit from KLAPjob?
I don't think it's only, you can say it's only competition. It's also because we see things differently. If you see on Bjørn here, what he told was when he was in a sheltered workshops and he was out in practice called help me
internship.
Then it was not good for him. So if I was working in the sheltered workshop, I would also see at Bjørn and see I don't think a job is right for Bjørn. Because what we can see is it was not going well. So many are concerned for the people we are helping, and they are not only concerned because there's a competition. They're also concerned because they see problems ahead for them. So it's also because we see things differently. But what we can say is that of course we also have people in getting a KLAPjob that's not working, and we send them back to the sheltered workshops where they are more happy than being in a job. But as Tina said before, it's very important for KLAPjob and Liv that the person with mental disability is the one choosing what is the right thing for him or her. But of what we did in the old days was we was going around in the sheltered workshops in Denmark, telling about we have those jobs. If you're interested, you can get a job. And that time, slowly, we get more people who want a job. And today we have on stock 900 people who want a club job, and we make around 600 jobs a year. So we have 1.5 year theoretical waiting time to get a club job. It's not like that, but we have very many people who want a club job. So we fixed it, but it had been fixed through the years, of course.
Okay, I think that would be it. I think we've covered the important elements to understand how KLAPjob works. So thank you very much to all three of you. I think it was very comprehensive and very well presented to help us understand how the program works and what the purpose is and what kind of the key elements to make it such a successful program, employing or helping to get employment to nearly 4,000 people so far. I think it's also obvious to highlight the focus on developing the jobs, designing the jobs, preparing the employers so they are ready to work with people with disabilities in those roles, and then kind of taking a step back and leaving it to a sort of a normal relationship between employer and employee, and being in this sense as normal as is possible. I think it was also, at least from my point of view, incredibly important, especially how Björn emphasized the inclusion, the social life aspects of getting a job, how that helps a person opens the doors to other opportunities, to other social interactions, to other roles. I think that's an element of employment that is very, very important. So thank you very much. I hope you participants found it very as interesting, at least as I did. If you still have any comments you would like to share with us or any kind of feedback, please do so in the chat. We are very happy to have you here with us today. And as a closing couple of words, of course, you can find more information about employment of people with intellectual disabilities in not only in Denmark, but in other countries as well on our website. So if you head to Inclusion Europe website and find Project My Talents for Diversity, there are the videos that we freshly produced about job carving and reasonable accommodations and other elements. There is a fresh European research on employment and training materials for employers. So you can go there and use that. We will be sharing the presentation and all the other documents related to the seminar today, including the video that we showed briefly, so you can revisit those and share them with your colleagues. And as a last thing, of course, I'd like to invite you to the upcoming seminars we have in this series, and that's next Tuesday again at 2:00 here in Brussels time. We'll be talking about kind of different policy instruments and legal instruments to support employment. We'll have people from the European Association of Service Providers. We'll have head of School of Law and Trinity College Dublin. And we'll have one of the researchers from Antwerp Management School responsible for the research that I mentioned before. So we're hoping to see some of you again next week. And after that, on the 22nd of September, we have another example of a program, then this time from Czechia, about supporting employment of people with intellectual disabilities. The presentation this time will be by our member Rytmus. So that would be it. I thank you very much to the speakers, presenters. Very happy that I finally got the opportunity to have such a extended and detailed conversation about the program. So thank you very much to Denmark, and thank you to everyone else who participated.
Thank you for letting us in on such a big audience. We're very pleased. Thank you.
Bye.